Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Abu Saleh. I teach at Raja Pyare Mohan College under University of Calcutta. This paper is titled as English Literature 1590-1798. This module is on Samuel Richardson and it is written by Saroni Roy, Senior Research Scholar at Biswabharati University, Bolpur, Santiniketan. So in this module, we'll discuss about Samuel Richardson, his life, his career, his growth as a printer, publisher, as a writer, and then we'll discuss some of his novels. Importantly, the main important novels like Pamela, Samela, and Sir Charles Grandison. We'll discuss some of summary of this these novels and some of the important issues and themes discussed on in these novels. Further, we'll also discuss the fight between Samuel Richardson and Henry Fielding, as it is well known in this history of English literature. He was baptized on August 19, 1689, near Mackworth, near a place called Derby, Derbyshire, England. And he died on July 4, 1761, near Pearson Green, near London. His ancestors were Eamon Stock, his father, also named also as Samuel, and his mother, Stephen Hall, became London tradesmen. After the death of his mother, his father married Stephen's sister named Elizabeth in 1682. He had best thing called Samuel Richardson had only common school learning. He perceived inadequacy of his education as latter to preoccupy him with some of his critics. Now we'll discuss early life of Samuel Richardson. Richardson started his early career as an apprenticeship to a London printer, John Wilde. Sometime later, completing his apprenticeship, he became associated with the Leakes, the printing family, whose presses he eventually took over when he set up business for himself in 1721. He married Martha Wilde, the daughter of his master, Elizabeth Leake, and the sister of prosperous bookseller of Bath, and became his second wife in 1733. 2 years later, Martha's death. Now we'll discuss growth in his printing career. With the growth in prominence of his press, went his steady increase in prestige as a member, an officer and later master of his stationer's company. During the 1730s, the press became known as one of the three best in London, and his prosperity, he moved to a more spacious London house. He leased his first three country houses, in which he entertained a circle of friends, including Dr. Johnson, who is a famous literary person, the painter William Hogarth, and the actors Colley Cibber and David Garrick, and many others. So with all these, Richardson secured a well position in the government as well as in the press circle in England. Till now we have discussed the growth of Richardson as a printing press person, as well as his influences in the London scenario. Now we'll discuss his emergence as a writer. In the same decade, he began writing in modest way. At some point, he was commissioned to write collection of letters that he might serve as a models for country readers. A volume that has become earlier known as Familiar Letters or on Important Occasion. Occasionally, he hit upon continuing the same subject from one letter to another. And after a letter, a father and the daughter in service, on hearing her master attempting her virtue, he supplied the daughter answer. This is the germ of the novel Pamela. With the method supplied by the letter writer and plot by the story, that he remembered of the actual serving maid who preserved her virtue and was ostensibly rewarded by marriage. He began writing the work in November 1739 and published it as Pamela or Virtue Rewarded in a year later. His other major works were Clarissa, which was published in 1798, Charles Grandison, which was published in 1753. So till now we discussed Sheridan's growth, Sheridan's early career, his growth as a press person, and then we have discussed the background of the novel Pamela. We will discuss generally the rise of English novel, how the novel became very popular as a genre in English scenario. So if we see that novel is a product of enlightenment, factors like rise of the print culture, increased rate of literacy, circulating libraries, spread of female education helped the rise of novel. As a genre, it catered to the demands of the middle class and reinforced its values. Novel was perceived as a new idea of realism, which advocated for verbatim recording of life as it was lived by people. Now we will start after discussing rise of English novel in brief, we will start discussing Pamela, which is an important work of Richardson. There are various editions of Pamela which you can look into. Now we'll discuss in brief. Pamela is published in 1740. Written in an epistolary form, which is as a form of letter writing. Pamela walks in the house of Mr. B, who lives with his mother. Pamela writes letter to her parents seeking advice how to thwart the illicit advances of Mr. B towards her. Her father replies her, asking her not to sacrifice her virtue at any cost. After the death of her mistress, Mr. B attempts to violate Pamela. She decides to leave but cannot leave immediately, as she has been secretly in love with her master all along. Finally, when she leaves, Mr. B brings her back, offering her to marry her. He has been transformed from a rogue to a gentleman by reading the letters of Pamela and being moved by her virtuous character. The novel has a second part, which is rather dull account of Pamela's post-marriage life, where she wins over all the aristocratic relatives who have previously disapproved of the man. The only eventful thing that takes place in the sequel is Mr. B's brief affair with widowed countess. So this is the general summary of Pamela. Now we'll discuss how Pamela was received, or the reception of Pamela. What makes the publication of Pamela such a phenomenon in English literary history is the controversy that greeted with the legion of detractors and parodies it inspired. A Danish observer went so far as to say that England seemed to divide it in two different parties, the Pamelists and the anti-Pamelists. The Pamelists would look into this young virgin as an example for ladies to follow. On the contrary, the anti-Pamelists discovered that it is a behavior of a hypocritical, crafty girl who understands that art of beginning of a man to her lure. Some critics then accused Pamela of being less innocent than she puts on her to be, simulating sexual virtue in order to make herself more desirable. Joseph Fielding was heeding this group. So far we have discussed the background of Pamela and critical reception of Pamela. We'll continue with discussing with Pamela now. Among the numerous imitation and parodies of Pamela that appeared as an anonymous spoof attributed to Fielding but never claimed by him, Samela published was in 1741. Fielding published Joseph Andrews about Pamela's brother, in which he directed his considerable wit and learning against, he believed, to be Pamela's shallow, sentimental morality, and against the general political and religious corruption of his day. And as he later did in Tom Jones, Fielding used Joseph Andrews to set out for his alternative view of that what a novel should be. Fielding's savagely funny send-up was one of the most parodies of Richardson's novel. Elizabeth Heywood's Anti-Pamela is another notable contribution. It bursts the not only the moral pretensions of Richardson's heroine, but also her vulgar tongue and her penchant of recording voluminous details and writing in real time. Now we'll discuss some of important issues discussed in Pamela. The issues of bourgeois ideas of morality, which categorically distinguish between good and bad women by standardizing certain kinds of behavior. Chastity or virgin is a more important sustain of certain judgment than goodness of heart, which has been discussed in Pamela. In the marriage market, it was the most valuable of the sellable commodities of a woman. Pamela used her chastity to a great extent to secure a wealthy husband like Mr. B. Another important issue Pamela discusses is the class system, which has been challenged as a servant is being married to his master, aristocratic master. Richardson propounds his idea of class, which he claims that success depends on individual effort rather than on family status. This gives an ironic ambivalence to the moral pattern of the novel. While on the one hand, it challenges the hierarchical structuring of society, on the basis of birth and lineage, something which is declined aristocracy and tried to sustain. On the other, it did not really care to judge the moral efficiency of the techniques adopted to achieve social and economical success, to the point that even advocated for commodification of virtue in Pamela. So till now, so far we have discussed Pamela, the important novel by Samuel Richardson. And after discussing Pamela, now we'll discuss Clarissa. As like Pamela, Clarissa has also several editions and versions. So let's see how Clarissa is. Clarissa was published in 1748. It followed the same tradition of Pamela, is also like an epistolary mode. Clarissa Harlowe is the younger daughter of the family. Torn between individual wishes and family obligation. Clarissa is torn between individual wishes and familial obligation. She is being forced into an incompatible marriage with some ugly person called Mr. Solmes. In order to dodge the marriage, she corresponds with Lovelace, a rake secretly planning to rape Clarissa. Going to tell him her inability to go with him, she is trapped by Lovelace to elope. She is brought to a brothel in London. Lovelace tries to attempt her chastity by arranging a mock fire. Clarissa understands the trick and rejects him immediately. Lovelace offers to marry, but she refuses. She tries to escape, but Lovelace again abducts her. This time he drugs and then rapes her. After the rape, Clarissa only thinks of her afterlife, completely disillusioned with his life. She endures and forgives everyone and finally dies showing a Christ-like tragic strain. So, as like Pamela, Clarissa was also written in epistolary form, but this novel was more experimental in nature, especially in dealing with epistolary form. Clarissa writes letters to her friend Anna Hoy and Lovelace, to his friend Boldford, through which the narrative is unfolded. The letters show an attempt at psychological exploration in Clarissa's and some extent Lovelace introspection and self-analysis. Such psychological depth is missing in Pamela, where letters are overloaded with moral preachings. So this is one of the differences of Pamela and Clarissa. We'll continue with discussing some more important issues discussed in Clarissa, like issues of family, marriage, and loss of agency. The first part of the novel deals with the struggle between Clarissa and her family. And it shows the oppressive family and how Clarissa is disturbed, and especially her growth is disturbed as an individual. It also shows the clash between parental dominance and individual inclination. Marriage as a tool of driving home economic profit and social security is another important issue. Compatibility of personalities is not so much in criteria here. The woman looked upon as an honor of the family in this novel. The second part deals with the struggle between Clarissa and Lovelace. The space is in brothel. Clarissa trying to live up with her esteem by rejecting Lovelace's offer of marriage. Clarissa's rape is the climax of the section. The issue is of now of a fallen woman. A violated woman is less of a victim and more of a wrongdoer. Clarissa's family and the rest of the society look her at as a runaway, a woman of questionable character. The option of marriage or inclusion in the mainstream of the society and life is no longer available to her. Prostitution or death are the only two ways left to Clarissa now. Clarissa chooses the latter and dies and forgives all. So far we have discussed Samuel Richardson's life, his growth, his growth as a writer, and then we discussed his two novels, Pamela and Clarissa. Both are very important novels and shows how they are related to society and how the author has tried to describe various issues, important issues, which are still recurrent in our societies. Now we'll discuss another important novel, Sir Charles Grandison, and let's see how the novel is. As like other two novels, this novel has various edition and illustration that you can look into e-text. Now we'll start with Sir Charles Grandison. It was published in 1753. The novel Sir Charles Grandison was published in 1753. This is the last and final novel of Samuel Richardson. This is the only novel with a male protagonist, an important departure from his earlier novels, where female origin leading role. The character is more important here than any other other things like story or setting. Charles Grandison is a man of character. He owns good looks, wealth, manners, and also good heart. Then the author discusses Grandison's love affair. Elements of medieval knighthood can be traced in this novel, as the protagonist rescues kidnapped Harriet Byron from the clutches of the villainous Prolix Fenn. But it is also a man of time and he's with a rational bend of mind as he refuses to join Prolix Fenn for duel. A love triangle, Harriet falls in love with Grandison while he already has an affair with the Italian Clementina. Now we'll discuss important issues, especially use of history in this novel. Sir Charles Grandison. Issues of moral perfection is one of the important themes in this novel. Sir Charles Grandison is almost inhuman in his perfection. He has everything that one aspires for: good looks, wealth, prudence, great character, etc. His scruples make him seem unnatural. According to Carol Flynn, Sir Charles Grandison is a man of feeling who truly cannot be said to feel. Flynn claims that Grandison is filled with sexual passion that never come to light, for ladies are engaged in rivalry for his attention and affection. He likes two of them almost equally and weighs the matter of scale of duty to decide who should finally stay in his life, and not according to the natural inclination of his heart. The another important issue is issues of religious conversion. The novel intervenes into the contemporary religious debate of the efficiency of conversion from Catholicism to Protestantism and vice versa. Grandison is unwilling to change his faith, and Clementina initially refuses to marry him over his religion. Grandison attempts to convince her to consider by claiming that her faith would not be at risk. Although potentially controversial to the 18th century British public, Grandison and Clementina compromise by agreeing that their sons would be raised as Protestant and their daughters would be raised as Catholics. This is quite interesting. The plan never materializes and Grandison marries Harriet, the girl of his own faith. Now we'll discuss how the novel was received. The novel gave away both favorable and not so favorable kinds of responses. Sir Walter Scott openly described the novel, claiming that there is little on the plot to require attention of minute reading. A plot overburdened with long conversation on moral and religious topics, something which can be easily followed even after a short nap. Jane Austen resorted to a mild, affectionate mockery of the novel by adapting it to a dramatic lampoon letter. She took inspiration in the fashioning of heroine after Harriet Byron, one of the expert in fainting, at times so frequently that she would hardly get a chance to recover from one fit to have fallen into another. Till now we have discussed three novels written by Samuel Richardson: Pamela, Clarissa, and Sir Charles Grandison. And now we'll discuss one of the important thing regarding Samuel Richardson's life, that is the rivalry between Samuel Richardson and Henry Fielding. Both are important writers of the period. The rivalry between Samuel Richardson and Henry Fielding is quite well known and discussed. Let us see how others have seen this rivalry. Alan Michie has rightly pointed out that more so than any other novelist, Henry Fielding and Samuel Richardson are placed in a personal and literary rivalry which began in 1741 with the publication of Samela, and which shows few signs of abating even today. While Samela was a response to the moral pretension of Pamela, Sir Charles Grandison was a reply to the loose moral impulses found in the hero of Tom Jones, written by Henry Fielding. While Fielding's chief functional device is comedy and satire, Richardson is dependent upon what Ian Watt has called formal realism. Fielding and Richardson give two models of femininity, which often counter each other. While Richardson heroines suffered because of their failure to protect their bodies, the most valuable of the resources of a woman could boast in the contemporary society, Fielding's heroine found a way to celebrate their bodies, drawing a kind of subversive power from their sexualities. The module is on Samuel Richardson, and so far we have discussed his early life, his career, his professional career as a writer and a publisher, printer. And then we have discussed three of his novels, Pamela, Samela, and Sir Charles Grandison. We have discussed the summary of the novel, various important issues and themes discussed in the novel. Further, we have discussed the rivalry between Henry Fielding and Samuel Richardson. Now, we'll conclude this module. In this module, we have seen how a new structure and of society was coming up at the time, replacing the old value system. And the novels of the time best capture this transition. In this module, we have seen how new structure of society was coming up, replacing the old value system. And these novels captures this transition. Relationships of class and gender hierarchy are interrogated in a new light in these novels of Samuel Richardson. The novels intervene in the contemporary debate over morality, problematizing the concept of virtue. At the same time, these novels explore the complex relationship between money, marriage, and social status. The novels also demand critical attention for bringing to light the issues of sexuality and complex negotiation with the idea of chastity. The module has also discussed in some details Richardson's much controversial friendship with one of the contemporary novelists, Henry Fielding. They are very different ways of writing novel and dealing with the problems of the time speak of rich socio-political cultural diversity of that age. So hope you have understood the module well, and to know the further things on this subject, you can look at the e-text nearby tab and also read some of the important books given in the further reading section. Thank you.